Well, good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
It's good to be here. Good to see all the friendly and familiar faces for the most part here. I'd like us to begin the second part of this service with another prayer. So if you would kneel with me where possible. Our Father in heaven, we're so grateful that we can be called sons and daughters of God. We're thankful to be able to meet together, to worship, to fellowship, to praise you. And we pray that tonight our minds will be clear, that our minds will be receptive, our hearts will be receptive, and that you will speak to us, give us meat in due season. We pray that you will anoint the lips of your servant with a coal from off the altar. And we ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
It was something that we were looking forward to, at least I especially was looking forward to coming to this camp meeting. We have had some really beautiful experiences since the last camp meeting, and God is working in the lives of a lot of different people. As I've talked with others, I see that God is wrapping up the work.
Yes.
And we are privileged to live in this time that we're living in.
Amen.
And so, once again, I'm thankful to be here. And tonight's topic is on Daniel chapter 7 and 8. And I want to just say a few thoughts before we go there about prophecy in general. I'll repeat this that was shared last night in Amos 3:7. Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets. Yeah. And as we look at the prophecies tonight, if there are those of you that, if there's anyone present, either online or in this room, that has any doubts about God, this should dispel any doubts that you have. Because when we see that God foresaw, that he knew exactly what was going to happen in the future, it should establish our faith.
Amen.
And I just heard from a couple of people just 2 days ago that they didn't believe in God. And I know that there are still people in this world that don't believe in God. So I wanted to mention that. And something else concerning prophecy. A recitation of history is speaking of a specific event, person, etc. in the past. We might talk about Napoleon. We might talk about the Roman armies at a certain battle or whatever. That event is a particular event. There's no two events exactly alike. And prophecy is simply a recitation of that event before it happens. It is a statement, whether it's in poetry, whether it's in symbols, whether it's just a bare statement of facts, or however it's communicated, whether we're talking about history or prophecy, we're talking about a specific event. So it's helpful to keep those things in mind when we're talking about prophecy. And so you need to take it in its context, compare, take every word, every sentence. It all has a bearing on the topic when we're trying to interpret. We need to be sure that this is the specific event that it was talking about. We need to take things in context. You can't just take an isolated verse out of a passage and make it say something that is in that doesn't even harmonize with the surrounding verses. So these are some valuable principles we need to bear in mind. And one more thing here from Isaac Newton. He says, "For understanding the prophecies, we are in the first place to acquaint ourselves with the figurative language of the prophets. This language is taken from the analogy between the world natural and an empire or kingdom considered as a world politic. Accordingly, the whole world natural, consisting of heaven and earth, signifies the whole world politic, consisting of thrones and people, or so much of it as is considered in the prophecy. And the things in that world signify the analogous things in this," etc., etc. But the point being here that the natural world is what is used as the symbols or as the tool to communicate the nations, the empires, the political events that are taking place. And thus we find, for example, in Revelation, there's a woman, there's stars, there's a sun, there's a moon that she's standing on. The things of this world, the things of our natural world, are used as symbols for entities, for events, etc. Moving on to our prophecy here in Daniel chapter 7. Verse 1, "In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven strove upon the great sea." When you have four winds, you have a lot of energy, a lot of strife, a lot of commotion. And we see a lot of those over in Philippines. Lots of typhoons. Every year there's a dozen or more that come through. Sometimes one after another, one on the heels of the other. What do the winds signify? We read in Jeremiah chapter 49, verses 36 to 37. "And upon Elam will I bring the four winds from the four quarters of heaven," etc. "I will cause Elam to be dismayed before their enemies. I will send the sword after them till I have consumed them." So it speaks about the four winds from the four quarters of heaven. And then in describing what happens, it says, "I will send the sword after them till I have consumed them." So the winds are representing war and revolution, strife, bloodshed, etc. There are other similar texts which tell us the same thing. Winds are a symbol of war, revolution. So Daniel sees the sea, he sees the winds blowing, and the waters, we read in Revelation 17:15, "He saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues." So waters signify people, nations, a gathering together of people. Four great beasts, in verse 3, came up from the sea, diverse one from another. So we have four beasts coming from the sea, which represent peoples, nations, etc. And the sea is being torn with war and revolution and strife. In verse 17 of Daniel 7, we read that these great beasts are four kings. So now we have some keys to our prophetic symbols. We have four kings, or as it says in verse 23, it uses kingdom synonymously with king. So we have four kingdoms arising from a populated area of various nations that arise through war, revolution, etc. This is what the topic of the dream is about. Isaac Newton says several animals, as a lion, a bear, a leopard, a goat, according to their qualities, are put for several kingdoms and bodies politic. Isaac Newton was more than a mathematician and a great intelligent mind. He was also a Bible scholar. Amen. And
he wrote more on the Bible than he did mathematics.
Mm-hmm. That's right. He wrote more on the Bible. For those of you listening online, he wrote more of the Bible than he did on mathematics. And this is a book entitled Observations on Daniel and the Apocalypse. So he's just acknowledging what we saw already in the verse, that the four nations represent, or that the four beasts represent four nations. Last night in our study of Daniel 2, we noticed that there were four kingdoms that were mentioned in Nebuchadnezzar's dream that was revealed to Daniel. And these were Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. We find once again in Daniel 7 a mention of four kingdoms. This time it uses different symbols to bring out different aspects. In the worldly mind, in an unconverted mind, one views the world and the kingdoms of this world as something of value, as something like gold or silver, precious metals. But in God's sight, we see the way God views these kingdoms in the dream given to Daniel, one of God's servants. And so this time different symbols are used, but for the same nations, the same kingdoms. And here we see their nature brought out in the eyes of God. A lion, a bear, a leopard, a terrible nondescript beast. So we see some different aspects and some more details of these same kingdoms in Daniel chapter 7. First of all, in the dream that we talked about last night, we saw the head of gold represented Babylon, and we're going to find that the lion in this dream represented Babylon. Incidentally, Babylon has lions that are winged all through its architecture and its art, on its gates, and just all over. And so it was a fitting symbol. In fact, all of these symbols are fitting for the nations that they represent. I don't know that we'll have time to go into a lot of those details, but we read in Daniel chapter 7, verse 4, concerning the first beast. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. Concerning this lion and what it represents, we read in Jeremiah 50, verse 17, Israel is a scattered sheep. The lions have driven him away. First, the king of Assyria hath devoured him, and last, this Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, hath broken his bones. So Assyria and Babylon are represented in Scripture, more than just the one Scripture, as lions. And so comparing Scripture with Scripture, we can see what the symbols represent. And Assyria, when you look up Assyria or Babylon in your encyclopedia, oftentimes it will have Assyria, Babylonia as one entry, because they amalgamated, essentially, and were considered one kingdom at one point. And God viewed them both as being represented by lions. The eagle's wings We read here, "Behold, he shall come up as clouds, and his chariot shall be as a whirlwind. His horses are swifter than eagles. Woe unto us, for we are spoiled." Jeremiah 4:13. So, biblically speaking, eagle's wings, one of the things that it especially represents is the speed with which something is done. And when we're talking about a ravenous beast and it's devouring its prey, it's doing that with speed. We're talking about a nation that is conquering with speed. Nebuchadnezzar was known as a conqueror. Nebuchadnezzar's offspring, his offspring, his descendants, were not conquerors. They ceased to conquer. And thus we see the symbology here of the wings were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man. So a change took place in the character of Babylon when Nebuchadnezzar died. And so going back to our Lamentations 4:19, our persecutors are swifter than the eagles of the heaven. So once again, we see the wings of the eagle representing speed and swiftness. George Rawlinson tells us, "Nebuchadnezzar rapidly recovered the lost territory, received the submission of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, restored the old frontier line, and probably passed on into Egypt itself, hoping to cripple or even to crush his presumptuous adversary." In the historical book here, Seven Great Monarchies. But as we mentioned here, the wings were plucked. It was made to stand on its feet as a man, no longer able to run and catch its prey. And Albert Barnes notices that the wings being plucked would denote the cessation of conquest, that it would extend its territory no further. And this was exactly what happened with his successors. The next thing is, he was made to stand on his feet as a man. We read here in the American Educator Encyclopedia, "Nebuchadnezzar, ruling from 604 to 561 BC, was the most powerful monarch who ever sat on the Babylonian throne. Nebuchadnezzar was succeeded by a line of weak kings, and the country was in a constant state of turmoil until 538 BC, when Cyrus the Great captured Babylon." So a secular historical record is confirming exactly what the Bible had foretold would be the case with the nation of Babylon. Man's heart is given it. "He also that is valiant, whose heart is as the heart of a lion, shall utterly melt. For all Israel knoweth that thy father is a mighty man, and they which be with him are valiant men." This is concerning King David, recorded in 2 Samuel 17:10. The heart of a man is contrasted with the heart of a lion. The heart of a lion being brave. Nothing can make it afraid. And a heart of a man can be very afraid. And as was mentioned last night in the message, when the hand began to write on the wall, Belshazzar was so afraid his knees were knocking together. And certainly it fits the description of him not having a lion's heart anymore. We read here, Daniel 5:6, "Then the king Belshazzar's countenance was changed, and his thoughts troubled him, so that the joints of his loins were loosed, and his knees smote one against another." I know someone who went through a divorce and situation with the kids, and one thing after another, losing her home and all kinds of things, and her joints literally just, her bones would not stay in joint. And she had to see a doctor for a couple of years to be able to try to recover from that. That's what fear can do. The next kingdom we saw last night was Medo-Persia. And here it's represented by a bear in Daniel 7. I beheld another beast, a second like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in the mouth of it, between the teeth of it, and they said thus unto it, Arise, devour much flesh. Adam Clark says the symbol of the bear as the largest species of these animals was found in Media, a mountainous, cold, and rough country covered with woods. So it's interesting that God used a bear to symbolize Medi-Persia. The bear would denote any fierce, rough, overbearing, and arbitrary kingdom, and it is clear that while it might have applicability to any such kingdom, it would better represent that of Medo-Persia. Taking the whole nation together, it was fierce and rough and unpolished, little disposed to friendliness with the nations, and dissatisfied while any around it had peace or prosperity. It was lifted up on one side, denoting the strength of it was made up of two nations. One was stronger than the other. And Isaac Newton points that out here as well. It had three ribs in its mouth, denoting three of the regions or the provinces that were conquered by Babylon, or by Medo-Persia, sorry. Babylon, Egypt, and Lydia. It was told to devour much flesh. And we read here from the historian George Rawlinson, until failure checked the military aspirations of the nation, a Persian prince was almost under the necessity of undertaking some great conquest. It was something that a king just had to do. Someone was telling me about Teddy Roosevelt, and I don't know if he had any aspirations for the presidency when he determined that he was going to ride his horse into battle and lead the charge, and he may have had that thought in his mind, but certainly these Persians, they, in order to establish themselves and be it was a sense of honor to conquer at least one nation, to go out and wage a military campaign and be successful. And very fitting description here, told to devour much flesh. The next nation brought to view in the prophecy is Greece. And we read here, after this, I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. So, a four-headed leopard with four wings. And we'll notice the four wings of a fowl. Perhaps one of the swiftest conquerors in history, before the time of airplanes and modern transportation, had to have been Alexander the Great. In 10 years, he had crossed, I think, 7,000 miles, conquering nations as he went with his troops. And, you know, other nations, it would take them years to conquer nations. These battles went on for a long time, but not in the case of Alexander. And when Alexander's troops would go into battle, I guess they had some methods of fighting, such as they had some long, almost like a spear that several men would hold. And these things were really long. And so they could charge and attack the enemy without the enemy even being able to reach them, to do any harm. And the use of that weapon necessitated them racing into the battle, charging. And of course, Alexander, with a recklessness perhaps, would be leading the charge. And so they were aptly depicted in the prophecy by this leopard with four wings, not just two. He was noted for the rapidity with which he could traverse great expanses of territory in Carta Encyclopedia. Uriah Smith notes, the Grecian Empire maintained its unity but little longer than the lifetime of Alexander. Within a few years after his brilliant career ended, in a fever induced by a drunken debauch, the empire was divided among his four leading generals. Cassander had Macedon and Greece in the west. Lysimachus had Thrace and parts of Asia on the Hellespont and Bosphorus in the north. Ptolemy received Egypt, Lydia, Arabia, Palestine, and Coel, Syria in the south, and Seleucus had Syria and all the rest of Alexander's dominions in the east. These divisions were denoted by the four heads of the leopard. God could not, or human intelligence, before, you know, hundreds of years before Greece had even become a world empire, could not have foretold that Greece was going to do this, that Greece was going to then be divided into four nations. It had to have taken divine omniscience. The next kingdom we noticed last night was Rome. And you can look in your history books and you can see the progression of kingdoms. You can see one kingdom conquering another and taking its territory. And so these things are just a matter of comparing history with your Bibles. But the fourth beast of Daniel chapter 7 is not like a beast that we are familiar with. It's not one actually in existence. It was called a terrible beast, something which was difficult to even describe. And we read here, after this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth, and it devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. So here's a beast that is different from all the others. It has 10 horns, and it's devouring, it's stamping out, etc. And in verse 23, we read concerning this fourth beast, and this is the angel speaking, interpreting the dream. He says, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down, and break it in pieces. And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise. In the vision of Nebuchadnezzar that was that Pastor Allen shared last night, Rome was divided into what? 10 kingdoms. And we see, and that was signified by the toes on the image. And here again we see 10 horns on this beast, signifying the 10 divisions that would arise. Now, in the case of Greece, when it was divided, all four were now still part of the leopard. It was four heads on the leopard. It was still the kingdom of Greece, though it was different kingdoms, I should say different governments, yet it was still Greece. And in the same way, Rome continues. It still is considered Rome, even in its divided state. So, and we'll see why that's significant a little later on. Uriah Smith says, how accurately it answers to the beast before us. In the dread and terror which it inspired, and in its exceeding strength, the world has never seen its equal. It devoured as with iron teeth, and break in pieces and ground the nations into the very dust beneath its brazen feet, talking about Rome. just describing how accurately it fit the description. And it was different. James White notices that it had seven different governments. And A.T. Jones notes that especially the Republican form of government that it had for a time. In these things, it was different than any other kingdom. The other kingdoms had monarchies. They had kings. And Rome was different. And it had 10 horns. Noah Webster, of the Webster Dictionary fame, says, in Daniel, a horn represents a kingdom or state. And we read here in Daniel 7:24, and the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise. And this is the angel's words. Between the years AD 356 and 483, it, Rome, was divided into 10 kingdoms, as noticed in remarks on chapter 2. Thus, the 10 horns are 10 kings, or kingdoms that arose out of this empire, noting the historical fact of the division of Rome into its 10 different kingdoms. We move to the next phase of Rome now, the 10 kingdoms, depicted by these 10 horns, or in Daniel's dream, or in Nebuchadnezzar's dream, I should say, the 10 toes and the feet all mingled with iron and clay. In Daniel 7:8, we read, I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. So among these 10 horns, another little horn arises among them. Then I would know the truth of the fourth beast, Daniel says, which was diverse from all the others, and of the 10 horns, and of the other which came up, before whom three fell. So when this little horn came up, three horns were uprooted. And Pastor Allen was mentioning the three kingdoms that were uprooted, the Vandals, the Ostrogoths, and the Heruli. And these kingdoms were uprooted because they were opposing Catholicism. Particularly, they were opposing the doctrine of the Trinity. And this is why there was such wrath against them. And so they ended up being annihilated. Okay, which had eyes and a mouth that spake very great things, whose look was more stout than his fellows. And verse 25, he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until time, times, and the dividing of time. Any nation has the privilege of changing its laws at any time it wants. They're changing the laws all the time. But this says that he would only think to change times and laws. And that's because there is one law, one origin of times and laws, whose laws and times cannot be changed, and that is God's. And so the scripture says he only thinks to change times and laws. And here it also tells us that these great words that it was speaking was particularly against the Most High. So this is blasphemy. And we read here that they shall be given into his hand until time, times, and the dividing of time. A time, you can compare Daniel 4 and some other passages mention this same time period. And a time was 1 year. A times is 2 years, and the dividing of time is half a time, or half a year, making 1,260 days. And as was mentioned, a day represents a year in Bible prophecy, Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6, and also Numbers 14:34. And So, first of all, we notice here that it arises among them. This little horn, if we look in history, the power that was different than all the others, the kingdom that arose that was different, that was a blasphemous power and fit all of these descriptions, was the religious political system that came to be known as the papacy, as the Catholic Church. In the things that we're going to be sharing with you tonight, we have no animosity against Catholics. We're not making an attack on Catholics, and we're not condemning anyone for being Catholic. And I know that there are a lot of sincere and honest souls that are Catholic. So this is not an attack upon Catholics, but prophecy depicts the organization, the Catholic organization, in prophecy, and tells us what it would do and warns us about it. And so I hope you'll listen carefully. The papacy became the strongest of these other kingdoms that arose at the falling apart of Rome. And this was in part because the capital city of Rome, the city that had been the glory of kingdoms for years, for centuries, was vacated by Constantine. He built Constantinople, and he removed the seat of his empire to Constantinople. And from then on, the power of the emperors became less and less, and the power of the popes became greater and greater. People looked at Rome as the chief city. Whoever was from Rome there was just a deference that was given to Rome. When you go to Rome, you might understand why. There's no other place like Rome. When you see the centuries, the millennium old buildings, the temples, the architecture, the Colosseum, and that's just a drop in the bucket. Everywhere you turn, there are these things. And the buildings that I have seen there, many of them were old, ancient, in the time of Rome falling apart and the papacy arising. So this was a very special city. And we read here, we'll come back to that in a moment here, but three horns are uprooted before it. We mentioned these three kingdoms. And James White also mentions the Heruli, Ostrogoths, and the Vandals. And it tells us here in Daniel and Revelation by Uriah Smith, the reason why they were plucked up was because they were opposed to the teaching and claims of the papal hierarchy and hence to the supremacy in the church of the Bishop of Rome. So this really was the reason, and we can find that throughout history. They're known as Arian barbarians. And I tried to put that together in my mind. Well, if they're Arian, that means they were at least believing in the Bible. And how can they be Arian and be barbarians? And so it didn't make sense to me, but somehow I just ignored that for years as I was growing up as a child. And man's eyes were given to it, denoting its deceptiveness, its cunning, its craft. We read in 1 Samuel 16:7 that God doesn't see things as man sees them. And man is always looking on the outward appearance. And we get all dressed up with our makeup or our high-heeled shoes. I saw some people coming to a gathering a couple of days ago, and And I thought, wow, I didn't know she was so tall. But she wasn't tall, she just had these huge boots on. But man is always looking on the outward appearance, and that can be very deceptive at times. And we see in the history of the papacy gorgeous display. You know, gold and silver in abundance, statues and imagery and artwork and millions invested in cathedrals, and you just visit church after church in Rome that is so adorned. You know, it took millions to build these places, marble and granite and pillars and ceilings that you know are hundreds of feet high in some cases, and just very fitting description. A boastful mouth that speaks great words against the Most High. A boastful mouth. In the First Vatican Council, we read that we teach and define as a divinely revealed dogma that when the Roman pontiff speaks ex cathedra, that is, when in the exercise of his office as shepherd and teacher of all Christians, in virtue of his supreme apostolic authority, he defines a doctrine concerning faith or morals to be held by the whole church, he possesses, by the divine assistance promised to him in Blessed Peter, that infallibility which the divine Redeemer willed his church to enjoy in defining doctrine concerning faith or morals, etc. So they claim infallibility. In Daniel and Revelation, we read here the self-approved titles of the Pope, Vicegerent of the Son of God, Lord God the Pope. And you can look up vicar in your dictionary. You can look up Vicegerent and some of these other terms. And you'll see that the Pope claims to be the vicar of the Son of God. And not only the vicar or representative, but we read here that he is called Lord God the Pope. That's a blasphemous statement, to claim to be God, to use the appellations that are meant to be for God. The Pope can never be bound or loosed by secular power, since it is plain that he was called God by the pious Prince Constantine. And it is manifest that God cannot be judged by man, etc. So this is blasphemy. Great words against the Most High. And here we read that the priests are called so many gods. And the next identifying character trait mentioned here in Daniel 7 is that he would wear out God's saints. He would persecute. And has the church persecuted? No computation can reach the numbers who have been put to death in different ways on account of their maintaining the profession of the gospel and opposing the corruptions of the Church of Rome. A million of poor Waldenses perished in France. And I had the privilege of going to France and visiting the Waldensian valleys. And as I learned and studied more of their history, I felt a sense of respect and reverence for those people. We live in the mountains, and we have to park the car about a mile away or so, and we do a lot of hiking, and it's we have to go up and we have to go down and carry everything in, building materials, lumber, and when we for the last couple of months it's been dry season, so our spring was dried up, so we've been carrying water from a spring to do our laundry and that sort of thing, and it's not easy work just walking yourself, much less carrying a big load. But these people lived day after day, year after year, in steep mountain ranges. during a portion of time, and by that I mean like decades, they were prohibited from coming any lower than a certain elevation. And so this was at a time when they were not just outright killed. This is when they were tolerated. They were forbidden to evangelize. They were forbidden to come lower than a certain elevation. So you'll see some churches. I have a picture of this church right here. It's built right on that right at that elevation. And so some of the reformers later on that went to visit the Waldenses when they learned about their existence, this is the church that they would go to. And they would meet with the Waldenses there. Some of the later on after the Reformation had gotten started and some of the nations of Europe had become Protestant, their diplomats to Italy, they didn't want to go to the Catholic churches, so they went to the Waldensian churches, and this is one of the main ones they would go to. They would go up to this elevation, and that's the only place they can meet. And so here we see one of the dwellings of these Waldenses, and here I'm inside a cave looking out. This cave was used for worship services as they were hiding from those that were seeking to destroy them. This is inside the cave, two different pictures looking up toward the entrances. And this on the left, top left, actually all three of these are the Waldensian center, the first one. This is the real Waldensian missionary college. And Ellen White actually visited this same place. And she writes about her visit to the Waldensian valleys and to these places. And she comments how they were more than 800 years old in her day. And so it was very fascinating to see. This is one of the tables that the teachers would stand at while they were instructing their pupils. And these are the men that studied here are the men that gave their lives for the gospel. They would go out with portions of scriptures in the hems of their garments with the purpose of evangelizing the world. They would for a living and for a tool to as an entering wedge, they would take silks or jewelry or different valuable items door to door and sell them. And as they began to speak with the people, they would turn the conversation to spiritual things. And when someone showed some interest, they would pull out a portion of scripture that they had hand copied in this room and leave it with the people. These people, you read the stories of these people. This college, incidentally, you can see the steepness of the terrain. From there, they had a view of the pass. They could view the only way into the valley. And so they always had a guard watching. And they were far enough away that they could run and hide in a cave or go to the mountains. Oftentimes, the border of France is actually only 10 miles, but it's, you know, steep, tall, high mountains. But they would sometimes head into France for safety. Not that France was any friendlier, but this was going on for hundreds of years. And when persecution was coming from Milan, from other places in Italy, perhaps there was freedom in France or in another area. So, but millions of those people died, and others. History records between 50 million and 150 million people were killed during the Dark Ages. And He relates here just some specific instances. You can look at the St. Bartholomew Massacre. And I went to the church that rang the bell to start the St. Bartholomew Massacre. And these historical sites take on a lot of significance when you know the history and what happened, and you realize that this is just a shadow of what's going to happen when the time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, breaks upon us. Have they worn out God's saints?
Yes.
They would be given into this, given to this, or this little horn power would be given this power for 3.5 prophetic years, which amounts to 1,260 years, taking into account the day for a year in prophetic symbolism principle that we've mentioned to you already. This began in 538. Justinian, the emperor, he made a decree that the pope was to be head of all the churches in 533. But that could not be implemented till he got rid of the Vandals, which he did right away, and got rid of the Ostrogoths especially, because the Ostrogoths were ruling in Italy. And they actually took the prerogative to appoint the pope. And they granted, incidentally, they granted religious freedom to the Catholics, even though they were Arian. And King Theodoric, he wrote a letter to Justinian, to Justin, the father of Justinian. And he spoke of religious freedom and how he granted religious freedom to the Catholics. And he requested respectfully that Justin do the same for his people. And the Goths were Sabbath keepers. The Goths did not believe in the Trinity. And they had the Bible that was transmitted to us through the school at Antioch, started by Lucian, where they translated, etc., and copied the true version of the Bible, not the corrupted Latin manuscripts and the corrupted manuscripts coming from
Alexander.
Well, Jerome had written his Latin version, and others had Origen, and others had corrupted the manuscripts by that time. And so there were two Bibles, even back then. But they had the true Bible. And you can see pictures of Theodoric, the king of the Ostrogoths, up until 526 AD. You can see his Bible in pictures on the internet. They have it in a museum. And it's called the Silver Bible. And it's one of the oldest complete Bibles that exist, actually. And it's a beautiful Bible, silver lettering on parchment. And it's beautifully preserved. And it's in the Gothic language, translated by Ulfilas. But these men that dared to stand against the papacy, they suffered for their stand. We read here, we read that it was to rule for 1,260 years. This began in 538 when the Ostrogoths were driven from Rome and Justinian's decree could go into effect. And the Pope had actually written letters to Justinian and was requesting that Justinian free him, liberate him from the Arian rulers. And 1260 years later, after 538 brings us to 1798, at which time Napoleon was in France, ruling France at the time, and his general Berthier came into Rome, and in reality brought an end to Catholicism. He took the Pope captive, and their intention was that there should be no more papacy. They desired to bring it to an end. Temporal properties were confiscated, etc. But a short time after that, a new pope was elected, but without the power. He remained without power until, I believe, 1870, at which time he lost all power again. And so it really it seemed that this was the end of the papacy in 1798, but as we know, that deadly wound was healed. And that's what another prophecy tells us about in Revelation 13, which we'll be talking about later. But it did indeed rule for 1,260 years. And did it think to change times and laws? We read here in a Catholic source, "The church has always had a strong sense of its own authority. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven," Jesus said. Perhaps the boldest thing, the most revolutionary change the church ever did, happened in the first century. The holy day, the Sabbath, was changed from Saturday to Sunday. And we'll talk more about that later. But did they think to change times and laws? Yes, you look in their catechism. The fourth commandment has been altered, not in their Bible, but in their catechism. The fourth commandment has been altered to read just simply, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." Yeah. Leaving out the identity of what day the Sabbath is and how to keep it. And the second commandment has been removed entirely, which speaks against images. And so have they thought to change times and laws? Yes, they have. God's times and laws. And this has a far-reaching significance, incidentally, because it's by the law that we have a knowledge of sin. So it affects our understanding of sin. And our understanding of sin affects our understanding of salvation and everything else. The nature of Christ, and on and on and on. So this was a pretty big change. We're warned, we're told by the Apostle Paul in 2 Thessalonians, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed." He's called the man of sin for a reason. Because sin is the transgression of the law. And they have changed the law. So no matter what kind of exterior a pope may put on, that pope is the head of a system. And the entire system is corrupt. I'm not going to judge any particular pope or his motives, but the system from its very inception is noted in prophecy as being a entity that is opposing and exalting himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he is God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. In Daniel chapter 8, we find another vision. And once again, it deals with the same powers. But by the time we reach Daniel chapter 8, Belshazzar, the last king of Babylon, is in his third year, and Babylon is just about off the scene. Babylon is going out. And so in the vision here in Daniel 8, the symbols begin with the second kingdom, not with Babylon. And the symbols, you'll notice, are from a different perspective. In Daniel chapter 7, we see the nature of the beasts. In Daniel chapter 8, we see in every case symbols that are from the sanctuary. Every one of the symbols is a sanctuary symbol. And so, the attention of the reader is directed to what Christ is doing at the same time that these political events are going on here on earth. What is Christ doing? Where is Christ? And so this is the backdrop for Daniel chapter 8. We see first of all a ram having two horns that is mentioned. And Daniel chapter 8 verse 3, I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns. The ram which thou sawest having two horns are the kings of Medi-Persia. So in Daniel 8, God has his angel actually telling Daniel specifically the names of some of these, of what these symbols represent. In this case, Medo-Persia is mentioned as being represented by this ram. The next animal brought to view is a goat. Daniel 8 verse 5, we read, as I was considering, behold, an he-goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth and touched not the ground, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. And the rough goat is the king of Grecia, and the great horn that is between his eyes is the first king. So once again, bear in mind that this is 240 years before Grecia became a conquering power. And so, and yet God is naming the name of the nation. And Greece was not a united kingdom at that time. Greece was made up of individual city-states. They didn't even have a king over the whole realm of Greece. It was individual rulers over the city-states. And we read here that the great horn that is between his eyes is the first king. It so happens that Alexander the Great was the first king. And he's the one that conquered Medo-Persia. And so God got very specific in this prophecy. Those that may doubt the existence of God, how do you explain that? How do we explain when God is so specific, telling hundreds of years before an event happens? Last night it was read Isaiah chapter 45 and other places were read, where God identified the name of the individual that was going to conquer Babylon 150 years or more before he was even born. And he told the method that he was going to conquer Babylon. You know, we can say, well, God doesn't love us. We might be able to say a lot of other things when we are just looking at prophecy, but we can't say God doesn't exist. And then, of course, when you look at other evidences, you can't say that God doesn't love us either. When God gave his only begotten Son. Amen. So, we need to be honest with ourselves. We need to be honest with ourselves. Kingdom of Greece. And there were four horns on this goat. And then there was a little horn that came off of one of those. And it's interesting that this point is mentioned because the next kingdom after the division of Greece into its four kingdoms. The next kingdom, Rome, was actually, the Romans are actually descendants of a Greek. And Rome annexed a portion of Greece before it began this conquering. So in two different ways, Rome came from one of these horns. Daniel 8, verses 9 to 12, out of one of them came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the pleasant land. And it waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host of the stars. And what do we talk about? How the things in the natural world represent things in the political world, things in the prophecies. It waxed great even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground, and stamped upon them, yea, magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily, and this is an added word, the daily was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. And a host was given him against the daily by reason of transgression, and it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced and prospered. And we saw that Rome, in Daniel chapter 2, was depicted, first of all, by the legs of iron, but it was also depicted in its divided state by the feet, partly of iron, partly of clay. And we find the same thing in Daniel 7, with the ten horns. Once again, Rome is now manifest in that little horn and in the ten horns that are not as stout as that little horn. So the divided Rome is still Rome, but in its divided state. And we see that Rome, this represented here by this little horn, has two phases. And these two phases are seen, as we've mentioned, in each one of those prophecies. And he magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. And this prince of the host is undoubtedly Christ. It can be no other. And we could share some verses on that, but we're already out of time, so we're going to just hurry along here. He shall magnify himself in his heart, the angel says, and by peace shall destroy many. He shall also stand up against the prince of princes, but he shall be broken without hand. So this is a defining this prince of the host, prince of princes, king of kings, in other words. This is Christ. Similar definition as in Revelation 19. Now, I want us to just notice real briefly here how the different chapters are all, how we can compare them all. We find this head of gold in chapter 2, represented here in chapter 7 as a lion with eagle's wings, and in chapter 8, it was already passing off the scene, so it wasn't around anymore, so there wasn't any representation of the head of gold there. But this represented Babylon. And then we have the breast and arms of silver in the image we studied last night in Daniel 2, or the bear raised up on its side in chapter 7, and a ram with two horns in chapter 8. This all represented Medo-Persia. In chapter 2, we have the belly and thighs of brass, or bronze. And in chapter 7, a leopard with four heads and four wings of a fowl. And here, in chapter 8, a rough goat with a great horn broken and replaced by four, all representing Greece. And finally, the legs of iron in chapter 2, chapter 7 of Daniel, mentions a terrible beast with ten horns and a little horn coming out of the western horn and representing the two phases of Rome, pagan and then papal. So, Just in closing, in Daniel 12, verse 10, it tells us, many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. Prophecy is meant to be understood by God's people. And it's not given to the world to understand prophecy. Spiritual things are spiritually discerned. And God designed it this way. Not that there's some mystery, not that there's some secret knowledge like you have in the occult. It's all very plain. But we have to compare Scripture with Scripture. And we have to view it with eyes that are softened by the Holy Spirit. Amen. So, once again, and some of my own relatives may be watching this at some time, and I appeal to you that if you're doubting whether God exists or whether He's involved in human affairs, you've got to deal with these prophecies and explain those. And I pray that you will see that God is interested, not just exists, but God is interested in human affairs. He has warned us about events to come, and He wants our hearts. And I pray that each one here will give Him their hearts tonight. So we'll just have a prayer first. Our Father in heaven, as we bring this study to a close, we recognize not only your foreknowledge, but your ability to speak and things happen. Not only when you create inanimate things and say, let there be light, but when you say that something's going to happen, you bring it about. Especially in the realm of human affairs and the things that we have been studying tonight. We thank you for revealing these things to your servants, the prophets. And I pray that we will take heed, that we will appreciate them enough to study them and to learn what you're saying to us and learn the lessons you want us to learn from these things. And that we might be recognizing these signposts telling us where we are in the history of this world and what we need to do to prepare. And we pray all these things in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. Amen.